I'd written a book called The Free, which was kind of my State of the Union address. It was about nursing and in terms of America, it was about healthcare in regards to soldiers and working class people and a nurse. And when I finished it, it wasn't a lot of fun to write that book because it was really serious and there was no, I usually throw in locations that I like to be in, but with The Free, it was a kind of a nameless Northwest town. It wasn't about place. So I said to give myself gifts when I was started writing a new book, I said, well, I'm gonna pick a place that I love, which is Central Nevada, which in a lot of ways, it's like Eastern Oregon. It's like the Steens area. And I said, well, I'm gonna write a story set on a ranch in the middle of nowhere, and I'm gonna be an old man. And ever since I was a little kid, I've wanted to be an old man for both the reasons that are kind of cool, because I always liked old men, and old men seem to know everything, and then they seem at peace with things. And also an old man because I was scared of living, and I just wanted it to be over with, and so I could be an old man and watch TV all day and not to have to try hard at anything. But then the problem with me is, so I grew up camping around this area I'm talking about in Central Nevada, where some of this book takes place. And so I started driving around there, and I realized that no matter what I try to do with books, as far as making them fantasies, and just an old man sitting on a ranch, you know, within a couple pages, the book took on a darker turn and a turn more, more the stuff I write. And I've been trying my whole life to escape the kind of stuff I write. But when I sat down, within three or four pages, Horace Hopper appeared, and Horace Hopper took over the book. And then it became about something that I've been struggling with for years, which is the idea, can you save somebody that's broken? Can you fix somebody that's broken? It's so easy to break a kid, and so easy to dent, scar up a kid, but it's so difficult then to fix them as they get to be adults. It takes like a Herculean effort, I think, sometimes to undent somebody. And it's surprisingly easy to dent them. There's a writer that I really like named George Pelicanos, and he was talking about incarcerated youth, but I think it's a scale that works for anyone that's been a bit beat up, which is he says, in talking about boys and being men, so anywhere from 16 to almost 30, he says it's our job as a society to get the kids that fall into the ditch and pull them out and put them back on the road. And they'll keep going back into the ditch, but we keep pulling them back, and most of them will stay on it eventually. His point was, don't throw away the key on any kid until they've, you know, hit the ditch so many times that they just kind of like it there. But the idea is that they'll outgrow it. And so as the novel progressed, I started thinking about the idea of this old ranching couple has a kid working for him, and can this old couple's just basic love of this kid undent him? I was thinking in broader themes too, and I always, before I even start, I always have big themes that I'm thinking about. And with this one, it was isolation and loneliness, which are two things I've struggled with since I took my first breath, I think. And then identity, and I was interested in identity because American identity is such a tricky thing. Who's a real American? What your ethnic identity has to do with your American identity? And those fluctuate and dissipate. And I was always interested in that. And the idea of identity, that you can come to America and reinvent yourself, which we're all brought up on. And so all those kind of themes were running around. So the themes of isolation, which is a sheep ranch. Isolation and loneliness, which is the wife and the couple is agoraphobic. So how rough is that to be a ranch, work on a ranch, and then be scared to leave your own house? So you're out in the middle of nowhere and then you're stuck in a house. So I guess I'll start by reading a section that kind of shows you the situation between this kid and this old man. By sunrise, they were on the road. Mr. Reese drove. Horace chewed Copenhagen and worked his hand exerciser and the bay gelding Lex. And the old mare, Honey, swayed back and forth in the stock trailer. "Well, I know it's early to talk, but I was hoping we might," Mr. Reese said. He held a cup of coffee in his left hand and steered with his right. "Well, what is it?" said Horace. "Well, I'll need you to be honest with me." "I'll be honest, even if it hurts my feelings." "Well, I'll try, Mr. Reese." Horace spit into an old McDonald's cup, and the truck shook as the road worsened. The old man slowed to 25, finished his coffee, and set the mug between them on the bench seat. "If I'm optimistic about my back, I have maybe 4 years left where I can work. As you know, after I heard it the first time, we hired Albert and his wife to help out. You were still in school. He and his wife had talked about buying the ranch someday, but then his wife left him and that idea fell apart. The reason I'm bringing this up is sooner or later, I'm gonna have to sell the place. We'll have to move into town or in with one of our daughters. I know we've talked about this before, but I wanted to again before you left. You seem a natural for this sort of work, and you're good at it. I know you're young and you don't have a woman or a family, and it's a lonely life. That's only something you know if you can take. What I'm saying is, after your boxing career, why don't you come back? We'll set out a plan for you to take over the ranch, for you to own the ranch yourself. I'd hate to see all the hard work we've put in these years disappear like it has with the Casey place and the Haas place. We've seen both of those go from working ranches to nothing. Now Morton's is sold too, and who really knows what will happen to it? Working a ranch is hard, especially if you're single. There's not a lot of money in it either. I know you've been skittish with us, and it's hard for you to accept gifts. I also know that it's been hard for you to relax around us, to trust us, but we trust you. What I'm trying to say is that Mrs. Reese and I think of you as our son, and we want you to have the ranch when you're ready for it. Horace looked at the old man but couldn't speak. Tears welled in his eyes. He looked out the window at the hills of sage and the distant mountains behind them. They drove for miles before he said anything. "Well, I don't think anyone's ever thought I could run a ranch," he said finally. "But that you and Mrs. Reese think I could, well, that's the nicest thing I've ever heard. I won't forget you said it, I really won't. You and Mrs. Reese saved me, I know that." "Well, you saved us too," Mr. Reese said. "And you helped Mrs. Reese. She wasn't herself after our daughters left. You know how she was, how she gets. You helped her." Horace again looked over at him. "There's been a lot of years I dreamed I was your son, a lot of years. But Mr. Reese, I'm gonna become a world champion boxer someday, and I don't know how long that's gonna take. And to do that, I have to move to the city. I have to change the way I live and where I live. I wish I could do both at the same time, but I've thought a lot about it, and there's no way I can. But boxing's such a hard way of life for us. It's not gonna be that bad. But the fights are hard to get. You're the one who told me that the other way of fighting is more popular now. MMA is more popular, but people still like boxing. They really do. So I'm not too worried," he said. But his voice grew uncertain. "I'll get the fights, Mr. Reese, and I'll be okay. You'll see. It just takes work. You're the one who told me that. You're the one who said if you just keep working hard, things tend to break your way." "That's true. I have said that." Mr. Reese's voice trailed off. He rubbed his face with his free hand and cleared his throat. "Can I ask you another question?" "Sure." "Why do you have to change who you are? Why do you have to become a Mexican boxer?" "Well, I should have never told you that," said Horace. Mr. Reese looked over at him. "I'm glad you did. I'm glad you told me. It's good to be honest, and I'm honored you'd share that with me, but I just have to ask why." "Because Mexican boxers are the toughest," said Horace. Everyone knows that. They go toe-to-toe. They're true warriors who never quit, who never back down, who are never scared. Eric Morales, he's never been afraid of anybody, not anything. Oh, I bet he has. He never has. I know he hasn't. But you're not Mexican, Mr. Reese said. Horace didn't answer. He rolled down the passenger side window as the sun began to come over the monitor range. He let his arm hang out, and the morning air was cool and smelled of sage and dust. Did I upset you, Horace? No, he said. But it wasn't true. He wanted to jump out of the truck. He wanted to be a million miles from that old truck. The thing is, Mr. Reese, there's no tough Indian boxers. But that's where you're wrong, the old man said. Suddenly excited, he slumped down in the truck's seat and steered with his legs. He took the wallet from his back pocket and pulled out a piece of paper with Mrs. Reese's handwriting on it. In bold letters on the top of one side, it said Indian, and on the other, it said Irish. Mrs. Reese and I went to the library and looked on their computer. We found out some things. There was a boxer in the 70s named Danny Little Red Lopez. He was part Ute and part Mexican and part Irish. Now, you're part Irish, and your grandfather Doreen's husband was from over there somewhere, and you're part Paiute. Now, that's different, sure, and he has some Mexican in him, but not as much as you would think. And then there's Marvin Camel. He was a flathead, and it says he was a champion, too. Now, flatheads are out of Montana. He isn't from Nevada, but it's close, not that far when you really think about it. And the last guy is named Joe the Boss Hip. It said he was the first Native American heavyweight world champion. But I don't want to be like Marvin Camel or Joe Hip. I know who they are. Horace fell silent for a moment and then looked at the old man. Mr. Reese, I don't want to be an Indian. No good fighters are Paiutes. But that's not true, the old man said. And you know it's not. That's your grandmother talking. It's a bad thing to say. Anyway, like I said, you're part Irish too, and there's a lot of great Irish boxers. I have a list of those on the other side. Don't bother, Mr. Reese, Horace said and shook his head. No one thinks I'm white because I don't look white. I don't look Irish, so I'm not Irish. But I look like a Mexican. Everyone who doesn't know me thinks I look Mexican. They really do. He again looked out the window, and his feet tapped down on the floor of the track faster and faster. He began to pick at his fingernails. His voice faltered. I appreciate all you're saying, Mr. Reese, but I am going to be a champion. I am. It's like the boat book says. To be a champion, you have to create your own future. You have to make it yourself. You have to build your boat little by little and brick by brick until it's unbreakable and unbeatable. And that boat will take you to the next level, to the level of champions. And that's what I'm going to do. But what if it doesn't happen? What if you don't become a champion? What will you do then? A winner doesn't think like that, Mr. Reese. And for the first time in Horace's life, he was mad at the old man. His voice shook. Don't you get it? A winner only thinks about winning. A champion only thinks about being a champion. The old man slowed the truck to a crawl and again looked at the boy. I didn't mean to upset you, Horace. I'm sorry, I am. I just feel I have to ask these questions because you're my friend and that's what friends do. They watch out for each other. What if you get hurt in some permanent way? I won't get hurt, Horace said. Anyway, I can't worry about things I can't control. A champion doesn't think that way. A champion only thinks of the things he can control, and he does the work on those so he can get to the next level. And when he gets to the next level, he just thinks about the level after that. He just keeps building his boat. Mr. Reese again rubbed his face and tried to think. He cleared his throat. I hate to bring this up, he said, and I hope you'll forgive me someday for what I'm about to say, but I feel I have to. I have to because boxing's so dangerous. Remember, Horace, I took you to your fight in Las Vegas. I've seen you box. I've seen what happens when you get pressured or cornered. I've seen how you panic. Don't bring up Las Vegas, Horace shouted. And tears fell suddenly from his eyes. His feet tapped harder against the floor and he fidgeted uncontrollably. A mile passed in silence and then his voice became nothing but a broken whisper. Please don't bring up Las Vegas. Please don't ever bring it up again. I'm begging you, I'm seriously begging you, Mr. Reese. It was just one fight. And I told you I never wanted to talk about it again, and you promised me you wouldn't. You promised me you'd never mention it, not ever. I did promise, that's true, the old man said, and I'm sorry I broke that promise. This conversation hasn't gone the way I was hoping it would go. I didn't mean to upset you so much. I'm not the most eloquent, but I mean well. I just want to help you. I'm running out of time, and I believe I have an answer to some of your problems and to some of mine, too. Horace wiped the tears from his eyes. I know what you're talking about, Mr. Reese. I do. I appreciate it. And don't worry, when I come back, I'll buy the ranch for a lot of money. One of my main goals is to make sure you and Mrs. Reese can live the easy life. You deserve that, and I'll make sure it happens. I'll take care of you both. And I'll take care of the ranch and all the horses and dogs, too. Everybody, I really will. You'll see. It's my solemn promise that I'll help you. And me, I don't break promises, Mr. Reese. I'd rather die than break one. But for right now, I'd rather we just quit talking. The old man nodded. You're right, he said. I've talked enough and I'll stop. I just hope someday that you'll forgive me. So that's just a little section of a kid heading towards a ditch and an old guy trying to figure it out and pull him out of the ditch before he hits it. The idea of boxing really was just, but I grew up with boxing just as a fan, and I read about it from when I was a little kid, and I liked it as a little kid. I subscribed to the Ring magazine, and in the back of the Ring, they had the life history of a boxer, a single boxer, and they were always tragic. I mean, they're not always, but I'd say 75% of them were just straight up Shakespearean awful tragedies. And I loved them. I loved the tragedies of them and how difficult they worked and how hard they worked and how so many of them were so close to getting somewhere. And even the guys that got somewhere by the end were too beat up to really enjoy it. So I was interested in that, and it's a kid's dream. He's the kind of guy that to feel love, I think Horace Hopper feels like he has to come to the house with a suitcase full of money and a Cadillac so someone will say they love him. So that's where that comes. Does anybody have any questions about any of this stuff?
What's he feeling that's prompting him to tears when he brings up, when the old man brings up, you know, hey, you know, it's kind of like you panicked. It's kind of impressed.
Well,
you're not that great of a boxer.
Well, see, the kid's really isolated, and he was raised by a white grandmother that's really racist. And so he's really ashamed of himself. He has no ethnic identity at all. And he's really kind of a misfit. And so he thinks boxing will save him because he can change. His big plan is to move to a city and change his identity and become a Mexican. And yet he's a kid, he's kind of just a kid, and he wants to be a world champion boxer, and he's been reading these self-help books on boxing, and he's an amateur boxer, because he lived in a small town in Nevada, and he was getting beat up all the time because he's a heavy he was really into heavy metal for a while. And so he's really lost, and so guys were beating him up because he had long hair and he was like a metalhead kind of kid. And so he comes up with this plan to change his identity, and the old man just calling him out on it, saying like, look, this is a really faulty plan and you're not a very good boxer. What are you talking about? And it's just like when somebody calls you on stuff, he's just shaking and he's embarrassed by it. So yeah, well, and it's that basic idea that he's so damaged he thinks this is a good idea. He thinks you really can change who you are. And you can be something great if you believe you can be great. No, in some regards you can, but as far as like a championship athlete, I don't know. So he knows all this stuff. He lives in a kind of a false reality. He's a kid who works on an isolated sheep ranch in the middle of nowhere. So he comes up with some crazy ideas. But I like him, man. He's a great guy, I think. He's been a good friend of me, old Horace Hopper. Like over a cup of coffee, I usually could tell you the story of a novel before I start it. Like the big things, I can tell you. tell you the themes of it generally, and then like the big overall arc, all the little stuff in between, and how the scenes unfold, I don't know. And usually it's all editing on that for me to get it right. But the big stuff I knew. And usually I have a reason for like this one, I had a real reason for it being the way it is. This whole book is geared for that, for the ending, and for layered for the themes I was talking about, isolation, loneliness, and identity. Well, I mean, I've always been a fan of, like, Eric Morales is my favorite boxer. And you ever talk to, like, Mexican boxers, if you read about them, it's all about being macho. It's all about being a true warrior. Like, guys break their jaws and don't quit. And people, like, fans don't like them if they're not like that. So it's like, if you're a young kid, it's just like liking heavy metal, or, like, young guys like crazy stuff. And so he thinks it's really macho and cool and... so I, you know, as far as like Golden Glove boxing, I went down to Arizona and I followed that. They went to the championships a couple times. Like I said, I've always kind of followed it. The sheep ranching I did for a few reasons. There's a Basque American writer out of Nevada called Robert Laxalt. And he, when I started writing, I didn't know, it was before the internet, so I didn't know anything, and I didn't go, I went to college, but I didn't take any writing classes or anything, really. And so I didn't know when I started writing, and this is before that, when I was 18, 19, I went to the local university, University of Nevada, Reno, and I went to their English department and found out who their main professor was and waited till he had office hours one day, and I went there and I said, who's a Nevada writer? Because I want to read a Nevada writer. And he goes, well, read Walter Van Tilburg Clark, which wrote Oxbow Incident, which is a movie they made with Henry Fonda. It's a really cool Western. And then Robert Laxalt, who wrote about Basque American experience in Nevada. And so I read all his books and I loved him. I was, for a few reasons, I loved him because he wrote about the area I knew. He wrote about kind of rougher people, which I've always liked. And he actually wrote novels, and he lived in Reno for a long time, so I was a super fan. So when I wrote this book, I wanted to pay tribute to him, in that. So I picked a sheep ranch for him, and how I got basically one of the big ideas for the book came from a horseback riding trip I did in the Steens in Eastern Oregon. I was with this old guy, my wife and I, and we were riding maybe 30 miles from the nearest, gravel road that you could drive on. And we came across a Peruvian sheep herder who was sleeping on a blue tarp with a couple dogs, and his boss hadn't dropped him food in 2 weeks. Now, he could eat a lamb, and there was fishing, and he had some food, and he had this old guy who did these pack trips. And the old guy could figure out how to talk with him because he didn't speak Spanish and he didn't speak English. He spoke, like in the book, he speaks Peruvian dialect. And so the old man and him had figured out a way for the guy to say, hey, look, man, I need food. And the guy told us this story, how his boss just was kind of a bad guy and he was completely isolated. And I thought, man, that's the saddest story I think I've ever heard is a guy that can't speak the language, relies on an unreliable guy for food, and is in the middle of the mountains by himself day in and day out for months at a time. And I thought, man, that's as lonely as it could be. It just stopped me in my tracks, and it was an image of him and that idea that never shook me. So when I wrote the book, I kind of dived into that aspect of it and read a lot about modern sheep herding, which relies a lot on Peruvian, Central American sheep herders, and they're not, a lot, some of the owners aren't that nice. They do stuff like that. They don't let them off the mountains, because with the Basque American sheep herders, they had the whole community. They had Basque people in all the towns in Idaho and Oregon and Nevada kind of looking out after them, and these guys don't.
What can you tell us about the new book?
It's about, in my own way, it's about gentrification in Portland. It's about a working class family in North Portland who've lived in the same house for a long time, and then their landlord decides to sell it. And it's kind of that argument of what to do. You know, the house, you know, 15 years ago was $100,000, and now it's $280,000. And it's not a very nice house, and it hasn't been fixed up or any or updated. And they don't know what to do. So it's kind of that argument. It takes place in 2 days and two nights. It's pretty intense. I like it. I like it. We'll see.
When do you think it'll come out?
I just sold it last week, so it'll come out in a year, I think. Yeah, it takes you kind of just get in the pipeline, you know. And then hopefully it comes out. I mean,
when you're writing, do you have other authors that you'll bounce drafts off of to get, you know, to have them critique it?
Before, yeah. I mean, I don't show anybody until I'm done.
Okay.
Because I'm if an old friend of mine reads I'm halfway through and he reads it, and he says like, "Man, that girl in it, I hate her. She's the worst." And she might be the best thing by the end. He might go, "I hated her for a while, but then, you know, I really liked her." But if I'm halfway through and I show a friend and he says something like that, then I might cut her out completely. So I do exactly what I want when I'm writing them, and don't think about anything. Well, I probably should think more about like commercial stuff, but I don't care about any of that stuff. But if a friend of mine doesn't like it, that's different. So then I might change it. So I don't, and I just kind of sit with it. Like that one, I sat with for a couple of years, maybe 3 years. I've been working on it, 2-3 years, where I don't show anybody for like 3 years. So you're just kind of like the weird guy. In noodling on something, and like that Tom Waits song, "What's he building in there?" I'm kind of like that. Like, you know, is he writing a book or is he just going nuts? What Don't Skip Out on Me was different because, and it kind of happened with this new book. With Don't Skip Out on Me, I made a mistake of when I was down in Mesa, Arizona. I went to the Golden Gloves Boxing Championships there, which is amateur boxing. And I had a day off from these two things I was going to do, and I drove down to Douglas, Arizona, which is on the border. And Douglas, Arizona is a really unremarkable town in a lot of ways, but it has a hotel called the Gadsden Hotel, and it's one of the most breathtakingly beautiful hotels in a town that doesn't really deserve it. And you keep wondering, why would somebody build such an amazing hotel in the 20s and 30s? In this kind of backwater, I guess would be the word, town. And it was like very like David Lynch world. Went into the hotel and there was not a soul in it. There was a couple old men living there, and I saw it. I looked around. It's beautiful. It's like an art piece. And then I started driving back to Phoenix, and I go, "Man, I gotta stay there." So I stayed there for a couple days. And then I made the mistake of trying to write that into this book. So I wrote 300 extra pages for Don't Skip Out on Me I had to create a whole other character just to get him so he could live at the Gadsden Hotel in this town of Douglas, just because I wanted to live there. And that wrecked like 2 years of my life, you know, because it just wasn't working. And I was like, you know, I start running and I start like, pulling out like the self-help books, and you're like, I gotta change something. So that happened with this book too. So you make mistakes by doing that, like by not showing anybody, I think. But once I get it kind of in shape, then I show a couple people, and then, you know. But my best reader, really, my wife's a really good reader. I have an old drinking buddy that I've known for 34 years or something like that, and he's a real big reader, but he's really lazy. And he's one of those guys that talks before he thinks. So what he'll do is he'll just quit reading it. And then he'll go, oh yeah, I forgot. And I'll wait like a month. And then I'll go, "Man, all right, I gotta know, what page did you get to?" And he's like, "Oh yeah, your book, man, that got really boring, man." And then you'll find out, like, he'll get to page 76, say, and then you look about page 50, and it starts falling apart. And by 76, you're like, "Man, I want to quit, too." So he's a really good reader just on that level, because a lot of people won't really tell you what they think, but he tells you in a real basic way, which is like, man, it's really boring. Yeah. So.
You've had a couple of your books made into movies. How much do you get involved in that process, or is it just sort of out of your hands at that point?
Well, early on with my first book, Motel Life, I got hired by kind of a fancy screenwriter. He liked the book, and he hired me to write the screenplay. He was too busy at the time, but he goes, sign with me, and I will teach you how to, and I go, look, man, I don't know how to write a screenplay. I'm not really interested in it. And he goes, look, I'll teach you how to write a screenplay. You and me, we'll go someplace, and I'll be like, you know, like your mentor. I mean, he really laid it on thick, and I'm like, Jesus, this is like things that really go my way. So I signed with him, and I, you know, they paid me to write a screenplay, but and suddenly that guy disappeared. And so I just wrote it like 9 months, 8-9 months, and no one really told me what they wanted or anything. And I just did what I thought was cool, and I love movies. So, and then I sent it off to both the guys, the money guy and the screenwriter guy, the business. They were partners, and then I just never heard from them again. And then I was like, and I got the check, and I was like, oh, that's because everybody says you could spend your whole life making things that no one ever sees. And you might make some money off it, you might make a little money, or you might make a lot of money. There's a guy I know that's put his kids through college writing screenplays that never get made. And then so I was like, and then finally, I called the guy, one of the guys, the hotshot guy says that I talked to him once, and he goes, I sent you notes. And I go, man, I don't think he did, I would have remembered. And he goes, well, I'll send them to you tonight. And that was the last time. That was whatever, that was 10 years ago. Another guy just said, well, in the story, one of the brothers dies. And it's about a story of two brothers. And he goes, what if the brother didn't die? What if he was in a coma? And the dad comes back. And I go, well, the dad's not in the picture, man. That's, and I get fired up. And then you're like, oh, I get it. This is how. But he goes, look, he would have paid me to rewrite it. And then you start, you know what I mean? Like, you're like, well, then you could go down all these different weird holes. So I decided early on I wouldn't get involved with anything. I'd just take the money, and I like movies, and I would try to sell it to the best person. And so I did. Like, with the Motel Life, I sold it to these two brothers that were pretty cool, and they promised me they'd shoot it in Reno, and they did. So you can't ask for much more than that. The problem is I disagreed with a lot of the things they wanted, but I don't think they would have bought it if I was there telling them all day long what I thought. And then with Lean on Pete, it was different because the guy, Andrew Haig, is a really cool director. Like, he's a real deal, really cool guy, and he promised he would try to shoot in Oregon. And he would. It's a book with horse racing in it, and it takes place at Portland Meadows, and he actually got Portland Meadows before they closed to let us film there. So he was a really cool guy. So I got lucky there with just a, you know, top-notch guy making it. And so that was kind of fun, just to be a fly on the wall. But again, I just kind of would go for a day or two and leave, because I would just go, oh, he wouldn't wear that coat. Like, I was I was with my wife, and I said, man, he wouldn't wear those shoes. What are they thinking? You know, these things. And I'd get really hung up on these little things. And I think I was right on all that, but it's not my place, so I just ran the other way. But it's fun. All that stuff's fun if you just think of it as fun. You shouldn't get involved in that kind of stuff, I don't think, unless you just think it's a laugh, because it's too, you know, you could go nuts. Like, you know, reading about Ken Kesey hating One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest so much. And, you know, you could see his point, but Jesus, it's a great movie. But that just seems like a lot of effort to get mad. Thank you for supporting your library. I love libraries more than anything. I mean, because libraries are like my kind of church.